Welcome to Speechless. Glad to have you here tonight, live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake, also playing live in St. Paul over SPNN. This is a live call-in talk show, so if you have comments or questions about the subject matter we're talking about, feel free to do that. If you don't want to call in, you can go to speechlessmn@gmail.com and give me your comments or and suggestions, and maybe I'll get back to you. This is all volunteer. That's why I say that. There's no paid people running the show here. And if you want to see some of the past shows, youtube.com/speechlessmn. And tonight's show, a lot of updates. Of course, broke the Sandra Grazzini-Rucki case, the problems with the judge, David Knutson, in Dakota County, and on this show, and we just have updates, a lot of updates on that Sandra Grazzini-Rucki case and David Rucki case and the missing children. And also, there was a press conference that Governor Dayton held, a ceremonial signing of family law bills, and I went down and filmed that. And so it's somewhat uneventful, but what you'll actually see what takes place in these ceremonial signings. The interesting part was the discussion that have the discussions about what's coming down the road in the future relating to family law. And in light of that, I have my guest Susan Carpenter back with me again for the second time. You have a blog called redherringalert.com.
It's redherringalert.wordpress.com.
Okay, and we'll get that up there so that people can see. And everybody, you need to turn off your cell phone while you're doing the show. Something I forgot to do, so get that done. Won't have those distractions. But you're a parenting consultant slash whatever, huh?
Mediator, yeah.
Mediator.
Divorce and conflict coach.
Okay. Yeah. And you've been following this Sandra Grazzini-Rucki case.
Right.
Quite a bit.
Yep. The media coverage has been kind of biased and selective. So I've been telling a little bit more of the story when I can.
Right. And this show here has the only show that's had live interviews with Sandra and her attorney, Michelle McDonald, covering this story. I should get David Rucki on sometime, too. But the big news is, well, actually, let's get an update here. And let's show the Channel 9. They did a news story, and we're going to use it for educational purposes about what was said, what wasn't said, and just go a little deeper into the story.
Yep.
So let's play that Channel 9 video, and I think it's a good summary to start out with.
Right.
Can a judge force kids to like a parent they say they're afraid of?
The Fox 9 investigators get lots of tips about nasty divorces and custody battles, and rarely actually take these stories on.
But this case highlights something called parental alienation and raises the question, could you lose your kids for turning them against your ex? Here's Trish Van Pilsen.
Family Court File 11-1273 is as long and tortured as the dissolution of the marriage it documents. Sandra Grazzini-Rucki, a former Mrs. Minnesota contestant from a multi-million dollar trust fund family, David Rucki, who once owned a multi-million dollar trucking business. They have fought over money, for sure, accusations of lies, fraud even, but if you want to know how really bad it's gotten, consider this. Right now, four of their five kids can't live with either one of them.
It's extreme because, first of all, it's in family court and not child protection, but it's happening all over to families all over. They're losing their liberties in this manner, their liberties to be with their children.
In this case, there's been no child abuse charges, but a judge thinks the kids have been traumatized by something called parental alienation.
I'm just really scared it's going to end really badly.
It began just 2 years ago, yet David Rucki says theirs is the biggest file in Dakota County Family Court. No way to know for sure, but we do know that when we made copies of the file, the courthouse printer began to overheat. It all boiled over Friday, April 19th, when the couple's two older daughters ran away.
Police escorted us to the house to make sure we didn't run. We went upstairs, put our stuff down, waited 10 minutes, and then we took off, enough for the cop to leave.
The Rucki girls say they want to be heard. They met with us at a hotel just days after they took off. We don't know who brought them here. Dakota County Judge David Knutson won't let them live with their mom, and they refuse to see their dad.
He was abusive.
Really?
In what way?
Emotionally, verbally.
My older two girls claim outrageous things about me personally.
A psychologist appointed by the court believes their mom has brainwashed them to think that way.
I mean, our mom was always our protector, but now there's no one there to protect us.
So what is parental alienation?
I think it's a sustained attack on a relationship.
Laura Thomas is a family law specialist at the University of Minnesota. She's talking in general, not about the Rucki case.
Rights to parenting time are constitutionally protected.
One parent might try to keep a child from another. Tactics might range from accusing the other parent of sexually abusing the child to much more subtle methods.
The mom presents the child with a toy right before the father is scheduled to come and get the child for parenting time. And so the exchange happens with, well, you know, you have this great toy, but now you can't play with it.
In the Rucki case, court records show David Rucki believes Sandra Grazzini-Rucki convinced their five children, especially the two oldest girls, to team up against him.
They're just whipped up into this frenzy.
His attorney submitted this example. Video of what she says shows Sandra and one of the children dropping blank checks from David's then business, along with his social security number and bank account number.
Kind of bringing the child into the adult world and you know, under her wing, and let's do this, her co-conspirator, and we're in this together, and your dad's the bad guy. And
in an affidavit, Sandra denied they proved that claim.
It could really be that the child does not want to see one parent or another, not want to be with them.
Michelle McDonald, who started an advocacy group called the Family Innocence Project, is appealing Sandra's case on constitutional grounds. Sandra's argued the kids don't want to see their dad because he's frightened them. She's submitted transcripts of angry voicemails and texts left on the kids' cell phones.
This is crazy stuff your mom's doing. What the f*** is wrong with you? You know what? You f***ing don't understand.
She's also submitted a voicemail she believes came from him and includes the sound of what she says is six gunshots, one, she says, for each family member. David Rucki says he doesn't have a gun. And there's this story.
He sat on our kitchen table and said that he was going to shoot all of us. He had six gunshots. He was going to shoot all of us, my mom included.
I think I said was basically, what do you want me to just put a bullet in my head and end it so you don't have to deal with this?
He probably had a short temper. There are five kids and things get crazy. Did he ever harm them? No. Did he ever stalk them? No. Did he threaten them? No.
Court documents indicate David Rucki went through domestic abuse counseling. Sandra says she technically did what the judge ordered, but the court believes she thwarted every attempt to reunite the kids with their dad.
They tried three different therapists or professionals in the Twin Cities to try that reunification while the children were still living with their mother, and it did not work.
Did you tell the kids that they should not see their dad?
No, I was not denying him. But it had to be on the kids, I mean, when they agreed to it.
The divorce happened, it was our way to get away from him. Yeah. And that's what we really wanted.
Judge Knutson appointed what he called a neutral expert to evaluate the kids.
In my article, I listed some of the symptoms.
Dr. Paul Reitman is considered neutral in that he was new to the case.
He's certainly not neutral with respect to parental alienation,
which he calls emotional abuse.
Higher rates for depression, higher rates for chemical dependency, higher rates for anxiety, higher rates for personality disorders.
Reitman is talking in general, not about the Rucki case. Except in cases of proven sexual abuse, he recommends a child be forced to reunite with a parent.
What is the alternative? To simply say it's over? You never have to see your father or mother again? At 10 years old, 13, 14, we're going to make you let you have that decision and you're going to end your relationship?
I've gone to court with clients and the judge has said, listen, I'm not going to make a teenager come and attend parenting time with you. I'm not going
to
do it.
According to Rucki case documents, Dr. Reitman suggested that parental alienation could put children in a similar psychological state to those involved in cults.
Do you feel you've brainwashed your children as though they've been in a cult?
No, no.
And when you read that accusation, what did you think?
It's absurd.
Parental alienation syndrome is recognized by some psychologists, not others. It is not an official diagnosis. According to court documents, Reitman strongly recommended the Rucki kids be taken from their mom immediately and begin therapy so they could be deprogrammed.
And like, those are some weird words, programming and reprogramming.
Reitman's report triggered an emergency telephone conference with the judge.
This was not an emergency situation.
On September 7th, 2012, Judge Knutson ordered Sandra Grazzini-Rucki out of her home, away from her kids that very day. He appointed a different therapist to deprogram the kids.
If you know anything about parental alienation, you don't, as in this case, take the children away from both parents.
The girls told the judge what they want.
The judge told me that kids have no choice and I have no choice.
Since September, the girls and their younger brother and sister have seen their mom twice. Short visits at Chuck E. Cheese and the Mall of America, supervised by the therapist.
No one listens, no one's there to protect us.
Yesterday, Sandra Grazzini-Rucki's attorney filed this with the Minnesota Court of Appeals. She argues Judge Knutson overstepped his authority and violated Sandra's rights when he made her leave her home and her children. She asks the court to set aside all the judge's orders and let the family be. I'm Trish Van Pilsom for the Fox 9 Investigators.
David Rucki is now working with a therapist on the relationships with his three kids who did not run away. His two daughters, who you saw in the story, have been removed from school for truancy.
But they haven't been seen since the last time.
Right. It's my understanding that's the last time they were seen. It's in that video.
Right. And they've been, so that was done probably 2 years ago, two mm-hmm. to 3 years ago.
Yep.
And they went up on the missing and exploited children's list at that time.
Right.
Very, very close to that. And who put them on that list?
I'm not sure.
I think Sandra did.
I think so.
That's my understanding, that she reported them missing.
I do know that, well, I've heard from Michelle McDonald that she and Sandra went to the FBI.
Right. Yeah. So, well, the first thing about that article, we're going to get into the parental alienation, but the first thing I heard that you really have to have ears to hear what was being said. Because if you don't know what's going on, this just goes right over the top of your head.
Right.
Fox 9 News said, we get a lot of calls on family law, but we rarely take them on.
Right.
And that is a telling statement. Because, well, one thing, I think they're saying that they thought this was important enough to talk about. But I remember being in a court case, Representative Mark Olson's court case, when he was accused of domestic violence against his wife, and talking to one of the news reporters there, and he said, yeah, when I first got in the business and I had to work the desk, the overwhelming majority of calls were about divorce and what the judges were doing.
I've heard that too, and back in the day when I was going through my 8-year ordeal in family court, I had made some calls as well. And they just said, we get thousands of calls. That's what they told me.
Right, and this reporter's answer was, then I said, well, okay, if that is taking place and they're complaining about the judges, and I said, don't you think there might be something going on with our courts and those need to be looked in? And he just goes, I suppose so. You know, and you should have paid attention to these.
Right.
Oh, right. By the way, Representative Mark Olson's judge was Judge Pendleton.
Oh. Uh-huh.
Who just got removed from the bench for lying as to where he lived.
Right.
And I've been complaining about that for 10 years. Okay. So, they rarely take them on. They've been ignoring these family law cases for years.
Yep.
That's my main point on that one. But you had to be able to know what's going on to hear that. Parental alienation. What do you think about this topic of parental alienation?
Well, there is the debate. You know, is it a syndrome? Is it behaviors? I wish I had brought, there's an article from a psychiatrist group who say that the reason it's not a disorder is because it's not inside of one person, it's a relationship problem.
Okay.
Either between the two parents or between parent and child.
Okay.
On either side or both.
Okay. But would you say that parental alienation takes place, that one parent can or will try to interfere with the other parent's relationship?
I have seen that kind of, you know, there's bad mouthing that goes on. There are little tricks people do. I have taught a high conflict program. And one of the things we talk about is in transitions for kids, especially younger ones, can be very difficult for those children. And so sometimes it's just the shift for the child that's difficult.
Mm-hmm.
But one parent will say, oh, see, our child doesn't want to go with him or her.
Mm-hmm.
So there must be abuse or something going on. They don't like that parent. They shouldn't have to go. And the truth is, if you do that exchange in a neutral place, that is gone. So just giving the children a neutral place for that shift can take care of those kind of things.
Right. Or if there's a third party
there,
do you think that helps too?
Sometimes. I don't know if it always does.
Yeah,
it
kind of depends on the third party person.
And it's hard
person.
To get a neutral party at exchanges. So I guess for me, I've helped people combat that. And what we do is you have to not be afraid yourself. If one of the parents is afraid or, you know, clingy with the child, that does transfer to the child. They don't want to go as easily. And I know in my own case, when my kids were quite young, they were 4 and 7 when we separated, there was a time that the kids would say, you know, I don't want to go because you're going to be alone. I don't want to leave you alone. My youngest was always doing that. I don't want to leave you alone. And if you kind of feed into that,
right?
I don't want to be alone either. I'm going to miss you. That is hard on your child.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
It does make it hard for them to go. And so what I would do is I would say, I'm going to have fun while you're gone. I'm going to be with my friends. I'm not going to be alone. I've got fun things to do. And so you go have fun. And when you get back, you know, then we'll have fun. Yeah. It'll be
you go
fine.
Have fun. I'll go have fun.
Yeah.
When we get together, we'll talk about the fun we had.
Right. So, I mean, you can make it easier. And there are some parents, I don't know that they're doing it on purpose.
Mm-hmm.
I think there are some cases they're just very clingy, or especially young children. There are some parents who really do miss them because, you know, they grow so fast and they developmentally, they're doing things you hate to miss. So I think parents would be, you know, do themselves a favor by realizing that sometimes we miss things anyway. You know, sometimes we're at work, sometimes the kids are at school, you miss certain firsts, and it's okay. There are other things.
Yeah, and so that's more on the parent. I mean, the parent.
Right. Right.
You know, and I think what happens after you miss a couple of firsts, you just realize, okay, it's done. An adult, a mature person would say, it's done, it's over, right. I missed that one. There's so much more left in life, and I can still, like, first time they ride a bike or the first time they take steps, you know. A grandparent could be over, and you just run to the store, and all of a sudden the kid's taking steps, you missed it.
Right.
You know. But you're there for all the other steps,
right?
You know,
I mean,
so yeah, that happens, but you can't control that.
So yeah, and some of it is how are people doing dealing with divorce in the first place, or some of them were never married, so now they're sharing time with someone they weren't expecting to do that with.
Right. Yeah.
And our system really isn't a very good place for those people. Getting situated. I don't know how I want to describe that, but the system really doesn't do a whole lot for you until things are really out of whack, but they also help push things out of whack. People are not always told what's happening. They don't understand the process. Attorneys aren't telling them. And then judges sometimes do really strange things, which increases the fear for those parents. And I think that's maybe what happened in Sandra's case.
Yeah, well, judges come in there and they have their own biases.
Right.
How family law should operate. Some of the judges are just out and out far left feminists. They hate men. Some of the men judges hate women.
Right.
You know, and so depending on the courtroom, you know, like Judge Perkins in Carver County, who would just destroy women, you know. But then you got a number of judges like Joanna Smith in Ramsey County. You got Washington County. Boy, I'm forgetting her name. She just had this hatred for these guys that would come into their courtroom. I mean, you can just see the steam blowing out her head and her manipulating and trying to manipulate everything she could do. Boy, I'll remember her name and I'll say it. But you see these judges and you go, there's no chance of fairness, or this is a messed up judge. You know, and you have that.
There are times you get into court and it just, it seems predetermined before you even walked in there.
Right.
You don't really stand a chance.
Yeah. This neutral evaluator, Paul Rettman, who was supporting the parental alienation.
Right.
My understanding is he spent very, very little time with Sandra.
Right. That's my understanding, too. There was only four of the kids were there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure why that is. And then it was only about 20 or 30 minutes total.
Yeah.
And then he made decisions based on that.
Yeah. I'm going to get personal here. I remember in my divorce case, you know, I had to go to do these things, some kind of psychotherapist or whatever. And we met for 10 minutes, and I got a clean bill of health. And I told the guy, what are you doing? And it was just kind of like, the very fact that you're asking me, what am I doing, tells me you're okay. You know, you can't do this. You can't analyze me in 10 minutes. And then he kind of goes, well, doctor, your psychologist, you know, said you were okay.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm taking his word at it. I got to pay you $250 for 10 minutes, you know, just to satisfy a judge, you know, and the judge will take your word. I mean,
Right.
It really bothered me, you know.
Yeah, it's crazy.
And then you don't get to see your kids for 5 years after that.
Right.
So.
Yeah, and one of the things with Reitman, I believe what they do then is take the children away from the alienating parent, not the alienated, but they'll take them from the alienating parent.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, but it gets into an interesting situation because then aren't you alienating the other parent now? I mean, aren't you just flipping it? Are we
right.
going to go back and forth in this reunification therapy?
Right. Yeah, very, very, very true. So in the Rucki case, Sandra was being the one accused of alienating, but now they just went and alienated all her kids from her.
Right.
With 1.5 hours notice.
And then, you know, they call it brainwashing as well. And uh-huh. I kind of have a problem with if you're that great at brainwashing someone to totally hate someone else, mm-hmm. Why couldn't she do it to all five kids?
Right.
Why couldn't she do it to the judge? Why couldn't she do it to David? You know,
right.
I mean,
yeah.
I don't understand. I find it hard to believe.
Yeah. And a parent could isolate their abuse amongst their children.
Right.
These are
true.
More vulnerable. I can do it with these two and not these three. You know, be
right.
effective, you know, or... So, hey, we got a phone call here.
Oh.
So, caller, do you have a comment or question?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I was going to ask, has anybody followed the money? Like in reference to, from what I hear, this is going on all over the country. They can break up the family and they take the kids away and then the psychologist can declare them that they need mental drugs. And then they put them on about 6-7 different types of drugs. And then forever they'll be on drugs. And so are you aware of this is going on all over the place?
Yeah, very much so. Do you have any comments on that?
I do. As a matter of fact, I wasn't sure if we'd get into that too much tonight. But I have written about that on redherringalert.wordpress.com. You can read about reunification therapy. I haven't followed the money, but I know the people have to pay for it. It's not covered by insurance. And there's some documents I have in that article that are from the state of Connecticut where a father challenged this reunification therapist because they're not a licensed therapist. And what the State Department of Public Health came back with was it's not real therapy. So they don't need to be a licensed therapist.
Okay.
So it's very misleading what it really is. It's really not a psychological thing, and it's not a legal thing either. And so to hold anyone accountable for it is very difficult because if you go over to the psychological side, they say, that's not our deal because it's not therapy. And you go over to the legal side and they say, it's not our problem because that's therapy. So this is where they create little places where you're stuck in between.
Feel good places. It's almost like there's another person who has their eyes on it, who a judge or the judicial system trusts so that they can get the go-ahead from that individual that says, okay, I evaluated this and I think this
right.
is what's going on. So it's more of a still a negotiation with a little more power.
Right.
Because judges give these people the power to make the decision. So it's another way to, you have a parenting expediter, parenting consultant, guardian, reunification
yep.
therapist, and your case may have all of them.
Right, and you have to pay for all of that. Most of it is not going to be covered by your insurance. Most of it is, you're not going to get, the only other place I know of reunification therapy, they use it with immigration for families who've been separated
right.
for a long time. And then when they bring the rest of the family over, they do
yeah.
reunification therapy.
Yeah.
But it's quite different from what they use it in
yeah.
family court for. They don't try to label people with mental health diagnoses and things like that. So, you know, it's questionable just because who is the therapist? Are they a real therapist? Can they label you with a diagnosis? I don't know. I don't like a lot of this stuff. It's kind of experimental. It's quasi-psych law.
Yeah. Well, then as far as following the money, you also get into the child support and the state reimbursement from the federal government of child support. And I've done many shows on that. So caller, you kind of have to go, and it's all over the internet, it's just how that child support system works. So go and call, do a Google search, child support, and find out how that works. So there's a lot of money in the situation. But time's going quickly already.
Right, I know.
But just some updates on the case here. Yeah. Sandra was arrested in Florida.
She was arrested in Florida. I think it was a week ago Sunday. I'm pretty sure it was a week ago Sunday morning.
Uh-huh.
It was 1:30 in the morning,
mm-hmm.
and the kids weren't with her. So, and now she's on a courtesy hold in
Florida.
Osceola County, Florida.
Okay.
Not charged with anything.
Not charged?
She's not charged.
So
this is a
Florida's
hold.
Just saying we're holding her until you, Minnesota, can get the paperwork done to get her out of here.
Right.
And my understanding is she has waived extradition.
That I don't
that
know for sure.
She has said, okay, you know, bring me back. You know, and I kind of think if I was her, that's probably a good thing to do. Get it done with.
Yeah.
Get it out of the way. You know, she has always said there's been a threat that this is one of the tactics. In private conversations, you know, judges make snide remarks, you know, and one of the accusations was David Knutson said, you come to this courtroom again, I got a warrant for your arrest sitting on my desk and I won't sign it till you show up. Well, then you got court cases before that judge, you know, and
right.
What's the basis of the, so you got these threats on your life, and I mean, you know, with these warrants, and you got your legal stuff to do, and you know, what's that about?
Yeah,
you know, so
yeah, I'm a little perplexed by the whole thing, really, because now this has gone on so long, but in most cases of parental deprivation, no one acts.
No one
will act. I mean, it's rare for someone to be charged with this, even when it does happen.
Yeah, it's very, very, very rare.
And I know of a case this summer where a parent was caught red-handed. Sheriff right there. It was a case where a parent was holding a child for several weeks. The parent worked with a detective, their attorney, and the sheriff to bring the child back.
Uh-huh.
And the sheriff was right there, and the parent was holding the child, so caught red-handed. And the sheriff warned, you know, this is a felony. Yep, parent didn't care, and mm-hmm. they just left.
Yeah,
nothing happened. The court.
What was the sheriff's reason for just leaving?
Family court will deal with it.
There you go. Standard
exactly.
answer. This is what this is. An educated. This is what these police officers and sheriffs are educated to say.
Right.
They see the felony right in front of them, and they go, family law, civil case, you know. And, I mean, it's messed up. I mean.
It is messed up.
I've only seen one case prosecuted, and it worked, you know.
Right.
Somebody was purposely withholding. No charges of abuse against the man or whatever. And the mother was just not going to let the kid see him. And the Washington County prosecutor prosecuted it. And he got to see his kids. Only case I've ever known of.
Yeah, it really doesn't happen much. And even Kimberly Sperling, who's been on your show.
Right.
She took the kid, one child, to Canada?
Right.
And she did seek asylum, but, you know, she's back here now.
Right.
Does it just go away?
Yeah, well, and other people have taken Susan Rice, took her kids to Canada. And Perkins, you know, she finally got arrested, but the appellate court just reamed Judge Perkins in another Carver County case, reamed Perkins and said, what in the world are you doing?
Right.
You know, you have denied this person so many rights. And one of the reasons for taking a child is abuse, where you can deprive another parent based on abuse.
You know, a good cause.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so they arrested Sandra, so she'll be coming back to town and
that's my
giving,
understanding.
Which I think puts Judge David Knutson in a tough spot because, you know, Sandra's already asked David Knutson for a hearing on where her kids are. And David Knutson canceled it. All right, we got a phone call here, so I forgot about. Caller, you have a question or comment?
Well, I am an attorney. I do some family law cases, and I just want to point out that, you know, your comment when you said that the common response is family court will take care of it. I had to laugh, and I didn't mean laugh in a funny way, but laugh in kind of a sad way, because for these really contentious family law cases, family court is the least likely place you're going to have a resolution of the case. That really, it takes attorneys who can help their clients step back a moment and think about the fact that their children are not property that they can fight over in some game they're trying to win. And that the children, by being caught in the middle, really, that this is having a detrimental impact on the way that they're going to be looking at things for the rest of their life. And so it's really, the solution can really happen in the attorney's office. And I find oftentimes there are so many attorneys who unfortunately say, well, let's just go and bring a motion. Let's just go fight it out in court because, well, like the other caller said, follow the money. Personally, I find that there's much better resolution when I have another attorney on the other side who says, you know, let's just save all the time and energy and let's not go to court. Let's see if we can figure out how to work out a bargain, a deal, an agreement between two adults who can't trust each other, and let's not treat the kids as property. So I guess that's my commentary on all of this, and so that's my shout out to all those attorneys out there who want to take care of these issues without going to court and involving the family court system.
Thank you, caller. Very good. And, right. And that's kind of the role that you play in this, is trying to help attorneys do that and the parties come to agreement.
Yeah.
Right?
I try to get people to work better with their attorneys. There are clients who are not cooperative, but a lot of it comes down to your attorney. The caller's absolutely right. If you have the right attorney, it's going to go a lot better for you. But mm-hmm. It is always better if you can work this stuff out and not go to court. I mean, court just causes a lot of resentment, and you've got the papers people file that say nasty things. I mean, they're never, if you're fighting over your children, you're never saying nice things about the other parent.
Yeah. Well, one thing the caller also mentioned was about property. Children is property. And, I hear that. And in one sense, I do see children as property. There's somebody controls them. Somebody, in one sense, owns them or has stewardship over them.
Right. That's
so,
a good word.
So I hear this word, and I think you wanted to talk about this, but parens patriae. So we got a graphic for the definition of the word parens patriae going to pop up here in a bit.
Yeah.
But why don't you talk about that? I mean, that's a big,
parens
big
patriae.
Issue.
Yeah. Originally, it was for adults or children who couldn't care for themselves, and maybe the state needed to take over that control. But it's been
and there would have to be evidence presented that met a high standard.
So it really, the legal definition here is Latin for father of this country, the term for the doctrine that the government is the ultimate guardian of all people under disability, especially children whose care is only entrusted to their parents. And under this doctrine, in a divorce action or guardianship application, the court retains jurisdiction until the child is 18 years old, and a judge can change custody, child support, and other things for the child's well-being, no matter what the parents may have agreed or the court previously decided. So that is kind of an issue, because now we've got the state over your children.
Mm-hmm.
And so especially these high conflict cases, when parents cannot work these things out for themselves, that's when the state is taking control. And they don't only take control of your children, but of both of you as well.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're going to try to work this out. So that's a problem with high conflict situations. And those would be the most contentious ones, too, that are going to have more parental alienation, if you want to call it that. And so how do you... I personally don't want the government to say that I'm only, the care is only entrusted to me. Like,
right.
They're the ultimate authority.
There needs to be a higher placing of the parents having that authority, having rights to raise their kids and their upbringing of their choice, and education of their choice. Otherwise, we have a national government, a Nazi Germany, a socialist society, and that we don't have the freedoms and independence that we've asked for, and that we are supposed to have in this country. Now, in this case with Grazzini-Rucki, you know, Sandra got arrested, okay, she's going to be extradited, but other people, warrants have been issued, files have been seized.
Right.
What do you know about that? One thing that made the news was they said Michelle McDonald's campaign advisor exercised a search warrant.
Dee
Evavold. And I know Dee Dee.
She's part of Red Herring Alert as
well.
Oh,
she is. Okay. So. And I know Dee Dee, one of the funniest persons I know. What do you know about that, or what they searched for?
They were looking for a lot of documents. I guess there's a list, too. A lot of documents. All her computer things. A lot of this came about because of Dale Nathan.
Right.
And he...
And you'll have to go to our past show to get that history.
But
he said things. I mean, he said certain people may have been involved or whatever. Of course, he didn't mention Channel 9 because Channel 9 saw the girls 2 days after Dale Nathan last saw the girls.
Right. Yeah. So I don't know what's going on with that Channel 9 news since they've seen them. But... They did also, I don't know if you're aware, that they did also do a warrant on Dale Nathan's home and take his property.
No, I didn't know that.
He has filed a lawsuit, but I don't know why he would think that they're not going to come look in there if he said he was involved.
Right. Well, he said he wasn't involved. He just knew the last time he had seen them.
Well, he has, he did a deposition,
okay,
which was
right.
A little strange. And he did say he was with Sandra in the car the night
right.
The girls disappeared.
That the girls told Channel 9 News that when they left the house. Yeah.
Yeah, so that's all I know. But his home was searched and they took... His computer and different things.
Yeah.
I don't know exactly.
Well,
I don't have his list.
This is to me, this is part of the bizarre thing. We're talking about these things and these search warrants just happening within the last couple weeks. But Channel 9 News did a story over two years ago, 2 days after the girls went missing, and there they are with Channel 9, and the police did nothing. You know, they didn't put things together, even though the FBI got involved, no warrants, no anything there. And so why all the interest now? You know, But I'm glad they're taking an interest. They should take an interest.
Right.
I think all parties, Sandra and David, wanted it to be, want their daughters found.
Right.
So they took all, you know, from Dee Dee, they took computers, you know, anything electronic, it seems there. But books, records.
Documents.
Yeah, books, records, notes, ledgers, other paper records. Yeah, anything paper that they can find. But it had to deal with correspondence with Sandra Grazzini-Rucki. Yeah. Mm-hmm. About her current and past location. Any evidence related to the disappearance of the kids, including possession of concealing and moving the stated parties for the purpose of depriving the legal guardian of their parental rights. So, you know, they're trying to find evidence that Dee Dee was involved and Del Nathan was involved, and who else?
They did also search and seize some things, if that's the right term, from Michael Radin.
Okay.
Who was involved with Sandra when she was here.
All right. And is a former...
I think she had stayed
Or he's
there.
A Hennepin County sheriff.
Corrections officer.
Okay.
Like
he's been a police officer, other things. And so his stuff got... he had a warrant for his computers and other things too, right? Same type of thing.
Right. And then he did claim there was $2,500 cash that was missing after the...
Oh, really?
The search.
Okay.
So that I've heard, anyway, that he filed a complaint about that. I don't know where that stands.
Okay. Well, what, you know, you've heard a lot in the papers. Star Tribune has been covering this quite a bit with Michael Broadcorb's articles.
Brandon Stahl.
What's your impression of what they're reporting on? Are they helping or hurting this thing?
I think Stahl has been pretty neutral. I haven't read Michael Broadcorb's recent stuff. I mean, but the things previously, they seem very biased. And
Well, he's the one that brought up the search warrant for Dee Dee Evavold.
Right. Dee Dee was told that Brandon Stahl is going to write about that Sunday.
Oh, this coming Sunday?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, that will be interesting to see what happens.
Right.
What I really find really unbelievable is nobody's talking about David Knutson's behavior in all of this. And actually, even one of Sandra Grazzini's other attorneys' behavior, because I read the transcript of the hearing that took is a very short hearing, and Sandra's attorney did not defend her at all.
Is that the phone?
Yeah, hearing? That was the phone hearing. Sandra didn't even know about it. Wasn't even part of the hearing, and there's Sandra's attorney just giving everything over, giving everything up. And
right.
So, I mean, what's your understanding of that hearing?
Well, I've read that. I actually posted it on Red Herring Alert. And it was filed in some of David Knutson's defense of his, the immunity lawsuit. There have been so many.
Okay.
But he just wanted to get the girls. What Reitman suggested, you know, we've got to get the girls away, or all the children away from their mother immediately. So there was discussion about, you know, how are we going to do that? We got to get Sandra out of her house.
Mm-hmm.
And her attorney, who her name escapes me, I can't believe that. But her attorney, who was not Michelle McDonald at that time, she did make a reference to, you know, how do we get around giving someone the proper notice? And, you know, I think she might have even mentioned that usually people have 30 days to get out of their home in other situations. And Judge Knutson said, you know, we got to move before the girls get their own ideas. Mm-hmm. So to me, that says there was a risk that the girls were going to run away.
Uh-huh. And he knew that. And I believe they told him, we're not going with their dad.
Yeah, and that is a kind of a question. At what point do kids get a say? You know, I understand.
And these kids were like 15. But you walk into any courtroom, and the age the kids have a say is 13.
Right. And even in that Fox 9 video that you showed, that expert on parental alienation, the woman, I can't remember who she was.
Okay.
But a professor, I think, law professor, she said that she's gone to court with people, and judges say, I'm not going to make teenagers go with you.
Mm-hmm.
So again, why was it so important in this case?
Right.
Wasn't there any way to work with the girls maybe
mm-hmm.
prior to, you know, I don't know. Some of the court things just make absolutely no sense whatsoever.
Yeah. So where do you think things are going from here in this case?
I don't know. my own opinion is mm-hmm. that an attorney could, I think it can be proven. Well, you know, I mean, you've got a couple things here. Sandra was arrested in the middle of the night. The girls mm-hmm. weren't there.
Mm-hmm.
So still they don't know where the girls are.
No, which is it's terrible. I mean.
So it is a question, did Sandra hide them or did they run away? So they're, it's not even clear at this point what happened.
Well, the FBI now has had these computer files, because what they did is they go in there and copy the whole thing, give the computers back, and now they're looking through them.
Right.
So I would think in these last 2 weeks they would have found something or had an idea where these girls are if these people have been involved.
Right. The raid or search on Michael Radin was a while back. I can't remember exactly when that happened. And this they just searched Dee Dee's home. I think it was Tuesday. Was it a week ago?
Well, it's a week ago. Tuesday. Yeah. It was quite a while ago.
Right.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yep. Lots going on there.
Well, anything
interesting to watch?
Yeah. Anything more in that case that you want to bring up or mention?
I don't know. I just do kind of think it's more politically motivated.
Mm-hmm.
Here in Minnesota politics, and then Minnesota family law, with Michelle McDonald on the case.
Okay.
I know of cases. My own children were kept from me, or one of my kids for mm-hmm. 4 months, and mm-hmm. you know, I wasn't going to get any help with that.
Right.
Well,
I think you bring up an interesting point. There's a lot of attorneys. There's a number of attorneys who are trying to bring to light what is taking place in the courts.
Right.
And how these judges are behaving. And actually trying to defend their clients. And the judges don't like that.
No.
And they don't like to be appealed on their decisions or to be called out. And I know I worked with an organization that every single attorney that if the judges tied them back to our organization ended up being disciplined. Complaints were filed against them. And it was as if they were trying to target these attorneys. Attorneys like Jill Clark ran for the Minnesota Supreme Court. It's disbarred. Mm-hmm. You know, they're going to pursue and go after. And Jill's very vocal about the corruption going on in the courts. But very hard to get our legislature to actually listen and take
right.
the time to collect evidence and data and ask questions. And yet you have judiciary committees, you know?
Right.
I mean, they should learn from the U.S. House of Representatives. I mean, they're actually investigating things and trying to get evidence out as to what's actually taking place in a number of incidents where government officials have behaved badly.
Right. Well, and people in the system like to point out in a case like this, you know, it's high conflict, it's 5%. I think it's more than that. I mean, there's really extreme cases like this one, 5%. But there's probably, you know, more 30 to 40% where there are these kind of issues like parental alienation, you know, just constant squabbles over the kids and mm-hmm. who gets them when. Mm-hmm. And so I really don't think it's just 5%.
Yeah. Well, you know, in closing here, and we're pretty much out of time, got about 45 seconds. I think what I would like to see, and when both parents go through this type of trauma and the kids, I'd still like to see reconciliation, because parents kind of figure out, wow, you know, okay, I did some things wrong here, one way or the other. I did some things wrong. And to get these kids back with parents who kind of have seen, oh, whoa, this isn't good.
Right.
You know, I've done some bad things. It's not going to happen. But, you know, unless there's just some real abuse problems. But we don't know yet because they haven't had hearings on this. They haven't explored it. So, all right, people, we're out of time. Go to redherringalert.wordpress.org.com to keep following this case and get updates on it. Susan Carpenter writes very well. All right, remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week.
Said to me that you wouldn't leave, but now I see that you're long gone. The days go by. Sets on fire.